I'm going to start with a confession. Despite being a fairly shy and quiet person normally, I have a long-held and secret desire. One day I would love to be able to make a grand entrance. So that was not a grand entrance. One day I would like to make a grand entrance. It doesn't have to be in church. There are plenty of opportunities. Some of you will know I'm a chaplain at a school, and so I get to speak up on stage at assembly, and that I think that's my moment. That could be my opportunity to make a grand entrance. And I've actually got the entrance in my mind, and I'm going to confess it to you because I don't think it'll ever happen, but I want you to share the dream with me. It's not original. It's been done before. But my vision is, our school gym is fairly large, has a reasonably high ceiling. I reckon we could rig a flying fox from the back down onto the stage. And I would love to come in just flying down that flying fox and arrive on the stage, grand entrance. I want to make the sort of entrance that needs a soundtrack. That's the level I'm looking at. We recently saw the movie Dune 2, the second in the Dune series. I don't know if you've seen it, but there are some characters in that movie that know how to make an entrance. It's fantastic. It's wonderful movies. Those entrances are greatly helped in the movie by a magnificent Hans Zimmer score. The movie score just makes it. And I suspect I'm not alone in this secret desire. I suspect that in our minds, most of us would like to think of ourselves with some sort of grand soundtrack. Perhaps we don't want the grand entrance, but we'd like to think that we have that soundtrack in our minds that sort of speaks to our level of importance in life, some significance that warrants its own theme. So I thought I might start today by having a little bit of fun with soundtracks. And I want to see what sort of thing appeals to you. So I'm going to leave this on. So just a little bit of an experiment here to see what sort of soundtracks might appeal to you. See, maybe you picture yourself as the kind of the gritty, tough street fighter type. You train hard for life. And perhaps something like this, if you're going to... Here we go. Maybe this is your soundtrack for when you arrive on the scene. You're coming into life. This is how you tackle life. Now, if that's you, own it for a moment. Just think, this is me. If you're sitting next to someone and you're thinking, I reckon that's what they're at, just give them a little nudge to say, hey, come on, we know that's you. You want that. So maybe that's you, but maybe you're not the kind of tough fighter type. Maybe you're like, no, that's not my thing. Maybe when you arrive in a situation, maybe you think of yourself in more stately and majestic terms. You know, you grace others with your royal presence. Maybe your arrival looks something like this. Is that you? Have you arrived? Yeah. It's amazing what a soundtrack can do. But maybe we haven't captured you yet. Perhaps you like to imagine yourself as a cool, suave, secret agent type, someone with some serious riz. Now, when you walk into the room, this is what's playing. You know what's coming. Some of you are going, I guess this is me. I should admit, it's going to get to me in a minute. I'm going to get dirty looks from one of my children, but we have a good game sometimes. That's enough, James Bond. Sometimes when that sort of music comes on, there's a few of us around the house, I'm one of them, that will start doing the imitations of, say, the gun barrel comes out and we're jumping around. Maybe that's you. Or maybe similar sort of idea, and this one also gets rolled out around the house a bit. Maybe you're a little bit more kind of action-oriented. Maybe this is you arriving. Ready? Are you here? Ready for life? That's a short one. We don't need too much of that one. I'm sure you... Look, I'm not going to ask you which one. We're not finished yet, but I want to see. Has anyone found their soundtrack yet? Has anyone... admit it. Yes, there's a few hands going up. Awesome. But that's all right. If you haven't found it yet, I think I know. We've got something for you. Some of you in life, you like to picture yourselves more as you're the superhero type. You're the ones that are going to save the day. This is inside you secretly think, I'm the one that's going to come in and save the day. When I arrive, people go, oh, thank goodness they're here. They're going to save the day. And you know this because when you come in, this is what's playing in your head. You know it's all our supermans and Or if you're not so much the superhero type, but you still like to save the day, this is the hero that my wife wished she married. There we go. I need my hat. I'm going to get my whip. If you don't know it yet, this should give it away. There we go. Indiana Jones coming in. We'll stop that there. We'd all love to have our grand entrance music. You can decide which one's yours. Maybe you've got another one. If you've got another one, let me know afterwards. I'll add it to my list. For most of us, though, let's be honest, Flying Fox into the gym, grand music playing, it's a dream. It's not actually, the grand entrance isn't actually going to happen, except in our own minds. Except for some people. Some people get to make a grand entrance in life. One example that springs to mind, this wasn't so much a grand entrance as a grand moment, but I mention it because it happened 2 years ago on March the 25th, so almost exactly 2 years ago. And it was a similar situation to perhaps the Palm Sunday events that we're going to think about in a moment. Thousands of adoring fans gathered in a stadium. And Lance Buddy Franklin kicked his 1,000th goal and they all swarmed the ground. They swarmed onto the ground. It's an amazing moment. This was Buddy's moment. The conquering hero surrounded and mobbed by adoring fans. He got to have his moment. And it got me thinking about sporting heroes and the way it's not just sport that does it, but have you ever noticed what we do with our champions? It's a weird kind of thing we have. So if we've got a sporting champion, and if you're at a sporting event, what we do is, if maybe they've just won something or we want to honour the past champion, we stick them in an open-top car and we drive them awkwardly around the edge of the stadium as they wave, kind of queen-like, and we all applaud and say, who is it? Who is that? It's this weird, it seems kind of pathetic to me, but where does it come from? Why do we do that? Just out of interest, does anyone know why we drive them around? Some of you will know where that comes from. We're going back to our Roman days. That's actually an old Roman thing. It's just kind of trickled through culture in different ways. The Roman triumph. The Romans did this properly. The Romans had this thing called the triumph. Now, a Roman triumph, there were other smaller versions of it. Keep scaling down and somewhere you get to the drive around in an open-top car. But the proper deal, the triumph, was a spectacular celebration held in the ancient city of Rome, and they were for a military commander who'd won an important victory on the battlefield. They had to be approved by the Senate, they had to actually grant it, and it was a lavish, entertaining propaganda spectacle, all about reminding people of the glory of Rome and its military superiority above all nations. Now, it got such a big deal that they actually, so many leaders wanted it to make a grand statement of themselves. They limited it ultimately to just the emperor. Only the emperor was allowed to have a triumph. Everyone else had to have the smaller versions of it. But they became ridiculously extravagant. And it was, if Hans Zimmer or John Williams or someone like that were alive back then, that was their job, was composing music for the triumph, for the entrance. That was it. It was a big deal. Which brings us to the events described in today's reading. It's Palm Sunday. And Jesus rides into Jerusalem, in this case, on a donkey. The crowds are screaming. The palm fronds are waving. It's a triumphal entry, the traditional image of Palm Sunday. But to help us make sense of that, it's useful to know that that may not have been the only parade in town that day. A couple of scholars, Marcus Borg and John Crossan, are often quoted. They make this point. Given that the Roman state, we know, always made a show of force during the Jewish Passover, when pilgrims had thronged to Jerusalem to celebrate. Now, it's Passover, so they're celebrating their political liberation from Egypt centuries earlier. Borg and Crossan imagine that there's not one but two political processions entering Jerusalem on that morning, the spring of AD 30. And one of them is a blatant parody of imperial politics. As on the one hand, King Jesus descends from the Mount of Olives into Jerusalem from the east, fulfilling Zechariah's ancient prophecy. Look, your king is coming to you, gentle and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. From the west, the Roman governor Pilate enters Jerusalem with all the pomp of state power. This is how they describe what it would have been like. So this is Pilate coming in, a visual panoply of imperial power, cavalry on horses, foot soldiers, leather armor, helmets, weapons, banners, golden eagles mounted on poles, sun glinting on metal and gold. The sounds, the marching of feet, the creaking of leather, the clinking of bridles, the beating of drums, the swirling of dust, and the eyes of the silent onlookers, some curious, some awed, and many resentful. On the one hand, Pilate's brigades showcase Rome's military might and power and their glory. And Jesus' triumphant entry, by stark contrast, is almost anti-imperial, anti-triumphal. It's a counter-procession, a procession with peasants screaming, "Save us!" A subversive vision of the kingdom of God. And Jack talked a little bit about that subversion last week. So that's the image of Palm Sunday and the Palm Sunday triumphant arrival. But what does it mean for us? What do we do with that? This is part of the bigger Easter narrative, but what do we do with Jesus' triumphal arrival? Do we imitate? Should we be making triumphant arrivals as Christians? One writer puts it this way as a response, and he draws on the words of Paul in his letter to the Philippians. On Palm Sunday, Jesus invites us to join his subversive counter-procession into all the world. But he calls us not to just any subversion, not to subversion for its own sake or to some new improved political agenda. Rather, Christian subversion takes as its model Jesus himself, who, this is from Philippians, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. The writer goes on, dying to self and the many demons of egoism and living to serve others will prove itself as sufficiently and radically subversive. And so Paul instructs us in his letter to the Philippians, have this attitude in yourselves, which is also in Christ Jesus. That's the attitude that we should have, that subversive entrance. But the big challenge is figuring out what that looks like. How do we live like that? How do we live as servants? Well, some things are obvious. Firstly, the power is appealing. We all love power. We long for it, we desire it, even when we know we shouldn't. But there's something attractive about power. Power, it gives us a sense of control, gives us a sense of stability and permanence. It makes us feel like heroic conquerors, that we can stand over and against situations or people that we don't like. But Jesus tells us not to seek power, as attractive as it might seem. Okay, so we shouldn't seek power. Does this mean that we shouldn't have Christian leaders? We shouldn't have Christians in positions of leadership in government, in business, in health, education, any other sector? It's not Christian. Well, no, I don't think that's the case. There's nothing wrong with being in leadership as a Christian, as long as the reason you are there isn't because of that love of power. What it does mean is that if you're a Christian in leadership in any position, you're called to imitate Jesus. In Paul's words from Philippians, you're called to do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but rather in humility value others above yourselves, not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interests of the others. Imagine if that described our leaders. Imagine if that was the job description for our politicians, for our corporate leaders, others. Nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility, valuing others above ourselves. If you're a Christian in a leadership position, is that all right? Well, that could be wonderful if that's your model and blueprint. But it's not just leaders. Power is not just for leaders. There's other ways that power gets wielded that we can be wary of. Sometimes we exert power under the guise of a good cause of some sort. An extreme example of this, cancel culture is a form of power wielding in the name of peace and protection. We must protect you all from this terrible thing that someone said, and so we're going to cancel them completely. I was thinking about cancel culture and thinking it's actually not unlike the Roman Pax Romana. If you're familiar with Roman history, Romans imposed, one of the great things they did in some ways was impose a peace around a large part of the world that allowed travel and commerce and trade and all sorts of things. But that peace and protection, the Pax Romana, came about and was defended by violence. It was a peace that was maintained by power and violence. The very same Roman power that Jesus countered with service and sacrifice. Now, it's easy to dismiss cancel culture, but there's others. What about influence and celebrity? And it's a different sort of power again, but it's still a power. Studies, there's different numbers thrown around, but there's studies that suggest, various surveys suggest that approximately, we'll say 57% is one of the kind of middle ground estimates. 57% of Gen Z aspire to be influencers, social media influencers, as a career, not as a, they'd like to do that for fun, as a career. Now, before we get all upset about Gen Z, 41% of adults say the same thing. And before we get too upset again, let's think about why they want to be influencers. Is it wrong for a Christian to be famous? Is it wrong for a Christian to have influence? Well, I would suggest, again, it depends on your motivation. If you're seeking fame and influence for the sake of it, then it's just another desire for power. But if fame and influence come about because of the good works you do, and if you're using that influence for the benefit of others before yourself, then that's going to look a little bit more like Jesus. Now, interestingly, when you break down the studies of why Gen Z want to be influencers, actually the vast majority of them, their main reason is to make a difference. Now, that encourages me. I don't get the whole social media influencer thing, but if they're going to be influencers to make a difference, and if some of them are Christians that want to make a difference by serving others, that's probably okay. But we should remember that fame and influence is fleeting. Human celebrity is fleeting. Jesus was a celebrity on Palm Sunday and then cancelled in the most extreme manner less than a week later. So yes, fame and influence might be okay, depending on how you use it, but don't hold on too tightly to it. There's other ways we can be tempted to seek power. Perhaps it's through wealth or status or strength. There's a whole male strength, I've lost the words for it now, but we talk about it all the time, a particular image of masculinity that seeks power through strength. That it's not a healthy one. But it's all about wanting power. All of these, even victimhood has been used as a way of gaining and wielding power. So we look for all sorts of ways. How do you test it? Well, they can all be tested with the same measure. Is it done out of selfish ambition or vain conceit? Does it in humility value others above yourself? So on Palm Sunday, Jesus presents an alternative to power. In the face of Roman power and glory on display, he presents an alternative, a subversive version of it. But that's only a moment in the story. At the Last Supper, only a few days later, Jesus models an attitude of service and sacrifice when he washes the disciples' feet. And then on the cross, Jesus makes his sacrifice complete. Taking a little side note before I finish, just one more observation, and some of us were talking at Bible study about this on Friday night, it came up. And that's this. At his birth, at the incarnation, Jesus, in Paul's words, made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant being made in human likeness. The work was begun then. In his life, Jesus modelled this servant nature in the way he lived and calls us to do the same. But all the humility in the world from us won't bring about the coming of God's kingdom on earth. We're called to follow Jesus' example and to serve as Jesus served. But only Jesus can bring about the coming of God's kingdom on earth. Only Jesus can do that, and did so by humbling himself, by becoming obedient to death, even death on the cross. That work that was started as Jesus set aside the very nature of God, set aside all the power that came with that, lived a life of service, ending in an ultimate sacrifice. It was because of that, and this is the next bit of Paul's reading, because of that, therefore, God exalted him to the highest place, gave him the name that's above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. We follow a Lord who has been raised. And we celebrate that next week at Easter. We will celebrate that. A Lord that gave up that power to serve. I started this sermon with a bit of musical fun, imagining grand entrance soundtracks, and now I think that maybe I shouldn't have a grand entrance soundtrack. Perhaps I'm being misguided there. So I thought I'd finish along the same lines with a character and a soundtrack that I think better reflects, it's not perfect, but it better reflects our calling as Christians to do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, our calling to in humility value others above ourselves, our calling to look not to our own interests but to the interests of others. Now, it's not the perfect illustration, but if you're familiar with these characters from book or film, you will hopefully appreciate the intent. And of course, it has a soundtrack to go with it. And this maybe is the soundtrack that I need to arrive with any time. I'm speaking, of course, of Hobbits. Let me read to you, and I'll give you the soundtrack at the same time, a very brief reflection on Hobbits. As you listen to it, it's only short, keep in mind that picture of Jesus subverting Roman power, of Jesus the servant and our calling to be a servant. On the one hand, you may find it strange that Tolkien calls upon the wee folk of his fantasy world to carry the day. On the other hand, if you consider the hobbit's diminutive stature as a sign not of a lack of courage or steadfastness, but rather as a lack of towering ambition and desire, the heroic role makes perfect sense. It's probably no surprise that a character from a Tolkien story captures part of the Christian narrative. Tolkien was immersed in that himself, and if you're a Lord of the Rings and a Hobbit fan, there's a whole other world we can talk about there. If you're not familiar with it, that's okay. I think you get the intent of it. We're called to be servants, to serve others. And like the hobbits, we pray that God will give us courage and steadfastness Pray, Lord, that you'll give us courage and steadfastness to serve you by serving others, and that you'll protect us from the ambitions and desires that call us away from that humble service. Amen.